Welcome, welcome, welcome. I'm the unknown meditator. Pretty soon, we may need to appear like this, actually, so nobody knows our identity. We're actually focusing on truth here? Wow. So, you better get ready for this. This is a mono, a facekini. It's called a facekini. We may have to go out in public like, nah, nobody knows who we are, because someone might say, ah, they're trying to get free of existence. Can't have that. Well, we do have to have that. Now, there's a fundamental difference between various teachings, a difference of emphasis. Right now, because materialism is so bad, I have discovered why it's so bad, so I can speak out and explain. Actually, I'm wearing this because I got my hair cut short. I said, ah, I'm not sure my hair is okay, so I'm gonna wear this instead. Or maybe not. Let me 1 second. Off with the facekini. Ah. All right, there we go. I actually feel better. Look at that. It's been discovered, verified and discovered, that materialism, which is this constant drive to structure the future, production, distribution, efficiency, scheduling, all this stuff, this produces a great fear of reality. In fact, truth will seem like threat, and reality will seem like an abyss, because truth leads to reality. Been able to confirm this. This is very, very true. So it's a disaster. It's a disaster, and this is not emphasized. It's coming down from the Dharma kings. Jesus points it out. Longchenpa points it out. I've been able to verify what they have to say. It is very true, and materialism in general has been pointed out as very dangerous for us. It's very, very bad for us. When we experience true reality, which is perfect freedom, there's no structure at all to reality. Reality is totally no structure at all. Every moment is fresh. We're completely free. When we get a glimpse of this, and our future is super structured, it seems like an abyss to us. It seems like reality will seem like an abyss. There's no way around it. There's no way around this. So when I say existence right now is very, very dangerous situation, it is for our mental health. Because the definition of mental health is to see truth as a threat and reality as an abyss. The definition of mental illness. The definition of mental illness is to see, I ate some popcorn, so I have these husks. The definition of mental illness is to see truth as a threat and reality as an abyss. That's the definition, okay, that I'm using. And this is the valid definition. Like, wow, that's pretty terrible, isn't it? Yes, it is. Do I have an adjustment on this? Sure, I do. Because the sun is going to start moving all over the place. So we'll dial this down a little bit. So what's the definition of mental illness again? To see truth as a threat and reality as an abyss. Okay, that's the definition that we're using of mental illness. And materialism breeds mental illness. The biggest product of materialism is mental illness. That's its number one product that it manufactures, actually. All right, above and beyond anything else, that's what is, and actually that's its goal, to manufacture that. Yeah, I got my hair cut pretty short. Pretty short. Number three on the sides. I said, it's time. It's time. Clean it up. We have work to do. Again, in materialism, you will find your life becoming more and more structured, so much ultimately the New World Order, which is what some have called the New Age, is really the New World Order. It's a bureaucratic dictatorship, global bureaucratic dictatorship, which aims to structure your life from cradle to grave. Socialism, communism, they're very good at that. We're going to tell you, you know, what to do. Everything, your life is already centrally planned out for you. And everything you do is regulated. This will cause you to have an extreme dread of truth, reason, truth, whatever leads to reality, to recognizing reality. You'll have an extreme dread of this. And you will view reality as an abyss of total annihilation. And since you are reality, you will feel that there's some terrible devil and demon inside of you that is threatening to destroy you. And you will then try to disassociate your mind and go into very severe mental illness, psychoses, etc., that are extraordinarily bad suffering. You try to escape the threat within. This is what happens. So this mental, global mental health alert is totally justified, the Dharma Kings have given out. But everybody's just lackadaisical about it. I tell you this, you cannot be lackadaisical about your path. You have to be very industrious, grind it out every day, you know, do or die attitude, or never say die attitude, do or die, never say die, grind it out, inspired, brisk, intrepid, steady determination. Keep on trying from every angle. That's what I do. I mean, I just try this angle, this angle, this angle, this angle. And if I get blocked in one way, I'm off to the other one, just like that. So I had some struggles doing some exercise taping. What did I do? Switched right over here to this taping. I started to get frustrated. When you get frustrated, just shift. Shift to something else from another angle and apply all these different angles to the central task at hand, which is what? Well, ultimately, it's guru vision. What our aim is, guru vision, vision of Christ, guru vision. And that shows us that there's really, this is all just a play of light. And no matter how the light plays, the light itself is never modified. It never stops being the light in any way. It never loses what it is. It's never diminished. Its quality and capacity is never diminished. Sort of like, take an example of water. Water is always water. The quality of water is what? It's liquid. It flows. It evaporates. It has these qualities. Now, even with water is like ice, it still has the qualities of water in it, right? Because it can melt. It can turn back into a fluid and evaporate and flow and all this stuff. So just because light appears to be frozen in this, the way we're looking at it, like form, we think there's form there, like frozen light, it hasn't lost its quality, its inherent qualities at all. It's really just pretending to be frozen. So ice, you look at ice, you say, oh, that's not water. It's water. It's water. And it really, the water hasn't lost its inherent quality, has it? It hasn't. It's just slowed down its vibration, you might say. But it can, it's still water. And you, if it melts a little bit, guess what? You see, oh, the water's there. And the water can flow everywhere and do everything that water does. So it's the same thing with the light. The light has not lost its quality at all. Now, what we do is 360 degrees. We're very Dzogchenist here. It is that we just continue to look at it this way and this way and this way. And there's no linear rhyme or reason to what we're doing. We're not trying to build a narrative, tell a story, graduated successive steps or anything. We take this step, and then we'll take this one, and we'll take this one, and it's just steps. Because what we're really honing in on is guru vision, which is the recognition that no modification has ever happened at all, anywhere. So what kind of steps do we need graduated steps can we take? Well, whatever steps we take, there's no undoing that needs to be done, actually. There's no undoing that needs to be done. So in other words, light hasn't lost, there's not something that needs to be cured. Light doesn't need to be fixed, healed, cured, anything like that. It's just we need to see accurately what's going on, instead of this very, very much misperception that we're engaged in time, believing in time, space, process, and form. So we don't have a narrative here so much. We keep shifting, so we don't fixate. Don't fixate on a narrative. I have no idea what I'm going to say next. I don't sit down with a plan. Oh, I'm going to say this or that. So your mind has to stay nimble in this way. Everything is grist for the mill. Everything you can apply. Say, that reminds me. That reminds me. Oh, yes, that reminds me. Everyone I meet now reminds me of the truth. They say something. They do something. Say, yeah, good. Thank you. You helped remind me of what I need to focus on. So this is really our aim, is to get to the point where everything that happens, that reminds me. Now, it may remind me I don't want to pay attention to this. Okay. Oh, thank you very much. This reminds me of, something I need to stay away from. Great. But they've done a great service for us, haven't they? Oh, activism. I don't want to be involved in activism. Thank you very much. So I'm going to, not follow that. So everybody is helpful to us. Everyone is happy, everyone is kind, we're on the road to Shambhala. We can view this. And again, sometimes they point out the negative, like, hey, this is really dangerous, this is what you want to stay away from. Thank you very much, yes, this is true. Now getting back, or just stepping into the world, what is its purpose? Its purpose is to modify what we are. So it's a malevolent purpose. I know some people see it as benevolent world, sometimes some malevolent. It's malevolent. Its purpose is to change what we are, but we're the ones who are projecting this malevolence. We're trying to drive ourselves into despair and hope that this despair can change what we are. Very simple. If you've really examined the world carefully, you will find this out. And the world is very exploitive. Nature is extremely exploitive. It tries to get everyone addicted. Addicts getting other addicts addicted. So they serve the other addict's addiction. There's nothing more dangerous than a drug addict, for instance, in the world. Why? Because when they run out of drugs, their total focus is on getting that drug. And it's truly astonishing what drug addicts will do. There's no more seductive being than a drug addict when they're out of drugs. Nothing can touch it. And you have to be very aware of this and very careful. Whether it's a man or a woman, what they do when they're out of drugs and their whole life says, everything narrows down to, I have to do whatever it takes to get that drug. And they become like great meditators or contemplators or one focused. They're almost in an altered state because they're so concentrated on it. And what they do is if they find somebody that has the drugs they want, what they do is they put on this act to make that person feel like they're the most special person in the world. The most special person, because you know what, to the drug addict, they are. They're the most indispensable, special, wonderful person in the world because they have the drugs that the drug addict needs. So the drug addict just says, basically feels like, hey, you are my world. You make me happy. You're my everything. And they come on to you. Like you're just the best person that's ever existed. Because to them, you are. Temporarily, until they get the drugs. So you may think, wow, I've just met my everything, I'm in love. You know, somebody just thinks I'm the greatest thing ever. I'm just the greatest person that's ever existed. And they're just madly in love with me. And no, they're an addict. Now, it doesn't have to be, I'm using this drug addiction to highlight something very important and extremely dangerous. As I said, this the most dangerous entity you'll ever come across is these addicts who will see you as you're just totally indispensable to them. And so they act that way to you, and you just think that somehow you finally found your soulmate. I mean, this is like, you know, it's going to lead me to nirvana. I'm finally appreciated. I'm finally seen as somebody who's worthy and has great value and all this stuff. And yet, actually, it's just the drug that you have for them, that they're after. And once they get that drug, they even don't even know you exist, really. Unless they think, well, I gotta get more drugs. Okay. Now, what they do is they say, oh, somebody, I have a supplier. What they do then is they want to keep that supplier. So what they want to do is they want to get you addicted to their come-ons so that you can't live without it. They want to make you feel addicted to specialness. So they treat you like you're super special. And then they want you to get used to that. So then when they withdraw that super special treatment you're getting, you're going to feel like the jitters, like, oh, I need that drug. I need the drug of feeling super special and valuable. And then when you give them the drugs, then, you know, well, you think, okay, if I give them the drugs, it will, I'll get it back. They'll treat me really special. So you get this sort of co-addiction. You get this co-addiction. But the addict is very good at getting you into this co-addictive relationship. That you think psychologically, I need them because I'm so special to them. No, you're special to them because you supply them with the drugs. If you don't stop supplying them with the drugs and you have no means, guess what? You're nothing. You're nothing. I was able to see that this is the fundamental activity of nature is co-addiction. It's like you have something I want, I'm addicted to. Therefore, I need to get you addicted to me and how I treat you. And so all of nature is this codependent addiction game that's being played, actually. It's amazing. And we tend to say, no, it's all benevolent. But nature is not benevolent. It's not this wonderful situation. It's a very shrewd, clever, it's actually a projection of our own minds. In our attempt to change what we are, modify what we are, it's a projection, and it takes on this very clever, exploitive, shrewd, you have what I want, so I have to addict you to what I can give you, so I get what I want from you. It's that kind of reciprocation of addiction. Now, I noticed all this today. I noticed a lot today, and I used the wow. I had to use the wow. Absolutely. And right now I'm in the wow. I cannot think so clearly. Because sharing this information it's extraordinary to see all this. Now, I also found out that everything here compounds one way or the other. So, both positive and negative, your bad habits end up compounding and driving you into worse habits. That if you didn't have those bad habits, would never happen. So I had an experience today in the opposite way. I saw that my good habits have compounded so that I'm not driven into a real terrible habit. I had the opportunity was there to get into a really bad habit, but I just didn't feel any pull to that because I've been taking really good steps to get free of this. And so the good habits are compounding for me. You see, the good habits are compounding for me, so I stay on track. But if I realize, well, if I hadn't have taken those steps that I've taken for good habits and good decisions, they would have compounded, the bad decisions and habits would have compounded upon me and driven me into a very bad situation. So I noticed a huge difference in my life, just like that. I was able to breeze through a situation that could have become addictive in the past. It may have become very close to being very addictive and gotten fixated in an addictive, a codependent addictive relationship, just like that. Yeah. So that shows tremendous progress on the path. Let's just think of how much that speeds up our path for us when we don't get stuck into a codependent, co-addictive, spiraling downward situation. For many, their whole lives are stuck in that. And they waste their whole life. Here, I was able to just sidestep it right off the bat. Didn't slow down at all. So this is the payoff from really great efforts and great habits. Now, the central addiction that we have in this world is called positivism. And we believe that we can heal our despair through a positivism and an abundance of it. But actually, this is all in control of despair. Despair is controlling this. Remember, the purpose of existence is to drive us into despair. So this, and then this despair is supposed to modify what we are. So despair will say, hey, it knows that we don't like despair. We're aware we don't like despair. So we think, how do we keep ourselves feeling despair? Well, the answer is positivism. That we'll tell ourselves that this, you know, positivity is all that we need. That's like the highest we can have. So, but we just need a lot of it. Like, look how beautiful nature is. Look at those flowers. That's called positivity. There's all sorts of positivity. Many try to be positive, very positive. Okay, but the purpose of that is so we don't turn to super positivity. So we've sort of short-circuited ourselves, sabotaged ourselves. Instead of turning to super positivity, we say, well, we'll turn to positivity. That's close enough. It's good enough. So it's this positivity that does not, that's actually despair is sponsoring this, the ego, despair, the strategizing of despair. Our desire for despair is telling us, hey, you know, just stick with this positivism. That'll work. Well, it works for generating enormous despair, yeah. It doesn't work for being liberated from it. We need the super positive to be liberated from it. So the number one commodity in this world for addiction is positivism. And so an addict, a positivist addict, materialistic positivist, humanist, they're addicts for this. Psychologically, they have a desperate need for positivism. So if they find somebody who's good at dishing out positivism, they're going to latch onto them and treat them like they're the most special being that ever was, and that they will always have this eternal love for them. And you get all of this, right? We know how it goes. I'm just madly in love. It's just, you have just everything that I can ever imagine. You know, so what they mean is you have the skills, ability to produce positivism. In a lot of different forms. There's many, many different forms positivism can take. Money, a lot of money, success, artistic abilities, you know, personality abilities, so many different ways. And so they will make you feel like you're just the greatest thing ever. And this is very, very seductive, because we're struggling here against the continuity fear, and it's a past very difficult, and we feel underappreciated, to say the least. The gurus help out extraordinarily important to have direct contact with the gurus, because they let you know that you're very appreciated. The Nyingma masters, for instance, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, and Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, have let me know in many ways. They say, we really need you. We really need you. Not just we need you to help us out. We are that keen on you. So that makes you feel appreciated. But the spiritual path is so difficult that we don't feel very appreciated. And so if someone seems to just like appreciate your every breath, you know, everything you do, it's just this, wow, is that seductive. And addicts are very good at that, at making you feel appreciated in the short term. Because to them, they appreciate the drug you're going to give them, the drug of positivism. They very much appreciate that. But if you don't give them positivism, they act like there's nothing here at all. There's nothing. You're a zero. Zero. You're a nothing. So just let this sink in and just wow it. Don't take a position on it. You've heard it, intuitively you know it's true, but don't try to take a position on it. It's extremely important that you not struggle trying to establish a position initially, because for sure you're going to have some regrets and say, why did I ever see that? That's going to make my life more difficult. I want to have rose-tinted glasses on, and now I see this, and oh, you know. And so you're going to be ambivalent. No matter what progress you make, it's accompanied by ambivalence, some ambivalence. It will be. So we must be very wise about this, and this is the whole key to success, is when this ambivalence arises, full stop in the wow. You're not struggling with that ambivalence. You're just going to sit here and feel ambivalent for a while. That's it. Because you know, you have faith, that truth will win out. You see, when you do this, it's faith. You say, I don't need to explain it. I don't need to struggle. I don't need to clarify anymore. I saw it. I recognize it. That's enough. It will come to me. It will happen for me. So you trust it. So don't struggle with the struggle, the ambivalence, the struggle of ambivalence. Don't struggle with it. Just recognize it calmly. So there's some calm in you. Say, oh, okay, ambivalence is rising. I expected it to. I'm not going to try to resolve it at all. I'm just going to trust that it will die down on its own accord. And it always does if you don't try to stir it up. So if you want water to settle, what do you have to do? If you want water to settle, you stop stirring it up. Like if it's choppy something, you're stirring up the bathwater. If it's all choppy, or splashing in a swimming pool, all this chop, and you want it to be calm, what do? You stop splashing. You stop splashing around. Thinking is splashing around. Trying to make a splash one way or the other. Just stop all of that activity and just wait. Calmly wait. Stop all that activity and calmly wait. And it will settle down. It always does. We can call this trusting it. I have to trust it. So if you want the water to settle, you just have to be quiet. Don't splash around. Don't splash around. Don't splash around. Don't splash around. You do your splashing and then you stop splashing and you let it settle. And you will continue to see more and more clearly what's going on, what this mental projection of nature is about, and the great dangers that we face here. It's truly, having been through those and having been hit by these dangers and experienced them, I can tell you they're absolutely terrible. When we believe that reality is an abyss that will annihilate us, then we see truth and reason as extremely threatening. And so what we try to do, since that makes us feel like orphans, like we're so detached, separated from what we are, it seems like, we then try to fill that feeling of like, wow, I'm really don't feel like myself at all. We try to fill it with what's called positivism. Oh, nature is so beautiful. Oh, you know, the body's so wonderful. Look at all the things we can do. Let's make more things. We can go more places. We can take more cruises. We can do this. We can do that. That's positivism. Stay optimistic. I got a nice, you know, yard, nice plants, this and that. Positivism. Say affirmations, optimism. I'm optimistic. I need to be happy today. I need to see the good people. That's positivism. And so we try to fill our lives with this sort of positivistic outlook, optimistic, positivist outlook, to avoid the sublime, which is what truth and reality, truth, reason, will start showing us our freedom. What reason shows us is our freedom. It's founded on the foundation of truth. So immediately we feel like, hey, I'm not really stuck. I'm not really, you know, you just glimpse it. This is what the positivists try to avoid at all costs. And so they're desperate for positivism. You can call it, and so they act like the muse. The muse is addicts, positivistic addicts, who are desperate for someone to provide them with this positivism. And so they act like an inspiration. And so if you produce a lot of stuff and then you get tired, here comes the muse, which is really the addict, saying, "Hey, you know, oh, aren't you wonderful? Aren't you special? Wow, you're amazing. You can do this and this. Oh yeah, I really, really love what this." And they're trying to stimulate you into more production. This is what materialism is. Materialism is this constant stimulation by addicts of more and more positivist, positive things, more and more of this, cars, this, that, jewelry, you name it. That, and then the producers are always being pushed and stimulated by the consumers, produce more. What came first, the prostitute or the addiction to positivism? The addiction to positivism came first. And then an addict is willing to prostitute themselves. Absolutely are. Use their body in any which way they need to in order to get, you know, their fix of that positivism drug. To them, the body is just a means to an end. It's a commodity, it's a means to an end. This is how I get the drug I need. So we have an extraordinarily materialistic, we have an extraordinarily addictive society. We have a global addiction crisis, which is really a mental health crisis. Alert, we're on alert, which means a severe crisis is about to happen, is likely to happen. And people look around and say, there's no problem, look, we have so many things, no, that's the problem. We're severe addicts. We just seemingly we can't do without it. And so we keep pushing. More and more of this and this and this and this and this and this. All the while, reason and spiritual path of reason, all that seems more and more threatening. We gotta get rid of it. Let's just go out and get some new shoes. Let's just go out and do this. Let's go out and do that. Well, we all do that from time to time, mostly these days. I mean, we're in such a materialistic world. It seems like almost criminal not to. So don't worry if you do a little bit of that. But what you have to do is a lot of the spiritual path, a lot of it. Getting familiar with truth, reason, truth. Reason, truth, reality. Reason, truth, reality. Getting familiar with it. That's the whole key. Then you won't be so addicted to positivism. You won't prostitute yourself. You will develop good habits, really great habits. Sobriety, seriousness. You're not, you know, overly desperate for positivism. You are desperate for super positivism, yes. But that's a different story. That arises from your own inner truth within you. You don't have to run to somebody else as far as an addict saying, you got to give this to me, you got to give this to me. It arises from within. The glimpses are from within. The glimpses of freedom come from our applying reason and right, you know, play of attention. And it bubbles into our mind if the freedom is like, and then it's like, wow, then the ambivalence arises. So, you see how it all works together, the path. The good habits, cutting down on materialism, our addiction to scheduling everything. I don't schedule anything. If I do, I feel very, very nervous and bad. I don't like it. I don't want any scheduling. I'm still able to function. I want each moment to feel like I can go any direction at all. So this is why the physical exercises are very important. I'm doing some tapings for some running exercises, different ways to run, different ways to move. It's very important to physically feel that you can go in any direction at any moment. Physically feel that. So the problem we have here is we can have this concept idea of 360 degree freedom. In other words, I'm not scheduled or structured in any way. But with our body, if we're telling our, we've told ourselves this is the way the body has to function, and we then end up thinking that the body is causing us to function this way. The body doesn't cause us to function in any way really, but we program our mind to say this is how the body should function, and so we have the body functioning this way. And yet it's so easy to believe that somehow the body is obstructing us. So it can help a lot to for the mind to allow this to program the body to say, you know, body, you can move in this way or that way or 360 degree. You can be walking along and suddenly you suddenly shift to go sideways, or you can pirouette and go backwards, or you can do a 360. You can do a 180 going this way and suddenly I'm going this way, or you can do a 360. You can go sideways, you can skip, you can hop, you can jump. That you feel you're able to go any which way physically. That is very, very important and extremely helpful, actually, in a subtle way. So I've been working on taping some exercises for you. So all of this stuff is very important. I'm trying to get it all into some way that people can more easily see it. But the resistance and the disinterest is so difficult. I don't really know what will work for people. They just keep thinking, just continuing to go along in the ways they've always gone along, and that will never do. That will never do. That is designed to produce despair, and we don't realize. We think, well, this is what helped me. We believe that despair is salvation. That's the ego's belief. The egoic belief, which is arrogance. Our arrogance believes that despair is salvation. So we condition our habits so that they produce despair for us. A certain sense that at least potential despair, you could say. And we think we're doing the right thing. So if we just allow the habits of the world to continue their play in our experiencing, we are just headed towards despair, actually. Now, you may think it works out great until you find yourself dying and then being born into another body, or not into a body, but identifying with another, the self identifying with another body, I identification, which the body lends itself to that. That's what bodies are for, to develop this false mind, sense of a false mind. Then you may start feeling despair. You're saying, I didn't want to come back. Oh no, not again. Then it can hit real hard. So it may not hit you this life, it might hit you the next one. Despair hit me this lifetime. Didn't hit me the previous one. Previous many I've had, but this one, it hit me full blast. Because I said, I don't want to be back here. I'm not set up to function here. I'm finished. I've done enough. And despair, you know, hit, just blasted me. And then it was, their hope was that it would change what I am, and it didn't. It didn't modify what I am. And then it was even worse despair, like, oh my gosh, the whole plan of despair doesn't work. So you cannot allow yourself to just coast along in the ways of the world. You have to be proactive. And that includes the spiritual, that this is what we're saying, the spiritual path, where we're used to kind of just, yeah, this is the way we do it, okay, there's like that. Even there, you have to be proactive. Because even there, the conditioning is such that it's leading us to despair. Well, I really tried, but I didn't quite succeed. You know, despair. So, proactive in not going along with the habits of the world, which are designed to produce despair in us. If not this lifetime, the next, or the next, or the next, it will happen. If you go along with the design of this world, despair is going to catch up with you at some point. For sure it will. And then that's terrible, actually. It's terrible. And you can't believe how terrible this is. You say, oh my gosh, it's caught me and I can't escape. It's jaws. The jaws of despair. I'm in the jaws of despair. I can't escape. So you'd better apply yourself and listen to what is being said here. Whether it's this lifetime or some lifetime down the road, despair will catch up with you. And the more work you do here of good habits, the less it will affect you. The less severe the bite it will have upon you. And the quicker you get free of it, this whole nonsense, the quicker you get free. So, when we talk about like walking different ways, running in different ways, moving in different ways, this is a very, very important issue, actually. And if you could just consider how you're functioning here, how many times have you walked into a store? Don't you walk into the store the same way every time, basically, right? Doesn't everybody? So it doesn't that get grooved in your mind after a while that I have to be linear, I have to walk this way, and this is part of a life that has to be a certain way. I need to follow these rules and regulations of this. This is what was going to work for me. It's all designed ultimately for despair. So is there going to be something that happens that where you walk into a store in a different way? Is that actually going to happen by how? An act of God or something? What is it? Does anybody, just look at older people, look at everyone, does anybody walk into a sports store in a different way? No, nobody does. So what reason will tell you that it's not going to just happen for you? You have to make it happen for yourself. You have to be proactively make it happen. Change the way you walk into a store. I do this all the time now. I'll be walking in a store and suddenly I'll start like skipping sideways. Or I'll pirouette and I'll make some really nice, I call them umpire moves. You know, baseball umpires, when they call a strike or they punch someone out, strike three, you know, they'll do just some little, you know, really nice little move. It's just like an umpire move, real subtle kind of move. I'll just be walking along, I'll just sort of just like snap my fingers and just turn my shoulders. I'll do anything I can do to make me feel like I'm still 360 degree, even though I'm walking into a store. Because when we're walking from the vehicle to the store, don't we feel like we're almost on a conveyor belt? Aren't we almost on a conveyor belt? Haven't we kind of lost a sense like I'm 360 degree right now? I can move in any direction. I'm free. Don't we lose that when we're walking into a store? So we get really conditioned. More and more and more. You go to like a store like Target or Home Depot and people are schlepping into the store. They get out of their car and they're schlepping in like zombies. And the people in the store are like pushing like zombies. We have to do this. How many times do you see someone in the store pushing their cart, going backwards? Well, sometimes they have to back out of an aisle, which is cool. But how about just like go down the aisle backwards in your cart as you're shopping a grocery store instead of going just forwards? Or how about when you put the cart down, how about moving sideways this way or doing a pirouette as you're pushing your cart? Just do a spinner, a 360 degree spinner, and then back to your cart like that. Little things that don't really catch people's attention. People kind of just, huh? And it's happened so fast, they don't pay any attention. Now, if you're singing a song and pirouetting and dancing and trying to make a spectacle of it, then people say, "What's going on? Someone's crazy here." But you don't have to do it to that extent. You just have to do these little things that remind you, "Hey, I'm not some zombie on a conveyor belt here." And this taping, I'm like that. I can be quiet. I can take quiet time. I can stop. I can kind of move this way. I can kind of move that way. I can get up. I can get up and leave. You know, I can do various things. I can even wear a luce libre face kini or something, right? It's very important to not do this to maybe make a spectacle, to be a comedian, you know, to fixate, to draw attention to yourself, anything like that. It's these subtle reminders that I am 360 degree freedom. And there's no way I can lose that. Therefore, the more I try to fixate myself, the more difficult it's going to be to, you know, get back to truth. I'm going to feel that reason is treacherous and dangerous, treacherous, threatening, and that reality is an abyss. Because reality is just a complete freedom, perfect freedom. There's no scheduling or anything. So I walked into Home Depot backwards. Yeah, I did. So I'm doing these tapes. I'll do some tapes. I don't know how it's going to turn out, or I never know what I'm going to do. So yeah, I don't want to promise anything. It's just that it may appear, and maybe nobody will watch them, because they're programmed not to watch this kind of stuff. They want some linear path that they feel like, yeah, I'm really losing my freedom, which means I'm really going towards salvation, because they think that despair is salvation. This is what we told ourselves when we tried to separate from God. We told us that despair is salvation, because that despair will change what we are. It doesn't. I can tell you with 100% certainty and accuracy, in no way will despair ever change what we are. I don't care if it's collective despair, individual despair, whatever. We can't change what we are. So it's a path to nowhere. It's just utterly futile, aimless wandering about, really. So we have to get back to reality, which is 360 degree freedom. And we then have to start being creative and inspired in our everyday habits, because everyday habits are how we build up more and more bad habits towards despair. Like we're zombies on a conveyor belt, robots. And one of the, you know, prime one that's easy to catch yourself is walking into a store. Or how do we walk in a mall, shopping mall, for instance? Now, you see, kids, they're not so programmed yet. And just look how they move. That's a natural way, actually. They're more in the now. They don't have their life structured. So they feel like, hey, this, hey, that. You know, hey, I can turn this way. Oh, this. You know, they're like, you feel the freedom of the kids, right? It's not all structured. So, but the adults... Oh, I'm scheduled. I'm on a tight timeline here. I got to do this. I got to go. So I've got to plot along here, and we think, okay, that's I'm advanced. I'm an adult. No, it's not advanced. It's deteriorating into despair. And it's cultivating a great fear of reason, and truth, and in a great, you know, in a great utter total dread of reality, thinking it's an abyss. It's cultivating that. And so you see people as they get older, what happens to them? I mean, they're in this assisted living.